Hello and welcome. My name is Maciej Mazur and I'm coming to you from Canonical. This is the company that you probably know best as creators and publishers of Ubuntu, the most favorite operating system for data scientists. But today we will be talking about MLOps. So in previous presentations you have heard how nice use cases you can build, how do you start from POC and so on. However, if your AI journey is in the like a middle stage where you are trying to productize it, you need a robust process which allows you to actually do it. So we are talking about MLOps because writing the machine learning code and doing the data science part of the equation is only a small piece of what you need to do in a real production. You need to monitor your model, you need to analyze how it's doing, you need to connect data to it and do a lot of different things. Not only the data scientist's work itself, and that's what we are going to talk about today. So there are many differences between use cases. So in the later stage, I will show you a few use cases where I was doing the implementation. However, typically, how you are starting your work, you have some infrastructure for your Jupyter notebooks, you do some exploratory data analysis, manually or automated, you have different types of data, not only standard tabular data that you know from a spreadsheet, but also pictures, videos, audios, 3D models, and all the other interesting things here. So obviously the process will be different for these types of requirements. Also, if you look at what are you actually doing with this data, you can do batch processing, split data into batches and do stuff more efficiently. Or if you need speed, you are using some streaming systems like message queues and real-time data analysis. Again, a lot of differences between those use cases. Also, data can be of a really high volume, like several petabytes per day, or high speed, like measurements from IoT sensors coming every 10 milliseconds, for example, in telco use cases. So, Canonical is part of a thing called AI Infrastructure Alliance. Basically, we are supporting open source communities and different products in creating the best solutions and architectures of it. So this is a sample blueprint of a workflow which data scientists and MLOps engineers typically need to follow. So this is a generalization, and we'll dive in into different use cases and see how specificities of those use cases are influencing this kind of models. So basically, besides the workflow, another very important part is the technical stack. So if you want to translate those workflows for actual software components and tools that you need to deploy on your infrastructure that you are hosting either on Kubernetes or somewhere else, then you need things like experimentation engine, serving engine, monitoring tools, and so on. And these two charts are going to help you when you are trying to figure out if you are missing a part when you are implementing MLOps and how to choose your tools and so on. So typically how ML project is starting, there is a choice to be made. So you can either take a ready-made single platform, which is out of the box, just click and deploy it. However, this might be more expensive than you need, or not having enough features, or having too much features, or actually create a tailored solutions. And what we see in most cases, people are going for a tailored solution because the ready-made single platform cannot do that. Let's look at the use cases. So first use case I want to talk about is customs documents handling. So one of our customers is a logistics company, which is worldwide one, and they have huge amount of customs declarations. So basically they have an OCR that is understanding the paperwork around a ship or a lorry or a container, and does all the legal checks and automatically fills in customs documents and declarations. So if we look at this from the process perspective, so in the workflow that you have, there are a lot of old spreadsheet type of formats coming from old Microsoft documents where some legal processes are explained, which is quite specific and not all the standard ingestion engines can handle that. Also, the customer has two different teams, ML engineers and data scientists, and data scientist team was purely academical and they were starting their career in IT and programming, and ML engineering team was actually a DevOps team, which was renamed to ML engineering team. So also a huge difference between them in terms of understanding the process. Also, the idea was that this is a batch processing. So after a certain amount of cases are built in, it runs the process itself. And also a data lineage was very important here because they had legal requirements to track all the decisions being made and how they were made. And basically what it required actually is to import data from MS Azure, because this was the only thing that could cope with the old spreadsheet type of files, and they had their own infrastructure run on-prem, like you guys can on ODB, and they were using tools like Pachyderm and Kubeflow for the main part of the process, and serving stuff with TensorFlow. So as you can see already here, there is a big composition of different tools needed to build such a tailored solution. Let's look at another use case from the same perspective. So the smart city monitoring one of the European cities built up a public services targeted solution where they had 5,000 cameras, 4K video streams, constant video streaming. It was doing facial recognition, license plates, accidents, and all this kind of stuff. And also they needed to store a really large archive of those video footage because they might be used in court. So basically they needed a huge setup with many NVIDIA 100 GPUs to be able to cope with that. And it was a high security environment. And again, if we look at the process, the main challenges here was the fact of, first of all, many 4K video streams. The ingestion is obviously complicated because you need to ingest them in real time, and even physical infrastructure might be a blocker here. Also strict access control, obviously, like a typical AI ML platform is not rigged for public services by default and out of the box. And also the fact that the whole training was done not on a single frames, like you typically do with the videos. You can use OpenCV, split the video into frames and do analysis on a single frame, like on a picture. Here, the context was important and what happened before and after a certain situation, like in a car accident or whatever. So the analysis was extended to several frames and the conclusions were connected. Also, the deployment to cameras and real-time inference were very important here. And because of that, the whole infrastructure was based on NVIDIA Triton because of high performance needs, and the whole streaming was done based on Spark Streaming and Keras. So again, completely different set of tools. Manufacturing process optimization, that's an interesting use case. So I was working with one of the biggest automotive companies. They have 7 factories in different locations. And basically they have the same process to optimize because they are manufacturing the same parts on similar production lines in different countries. So there were huge amount of devices like sensors, actuators, and so on with digital twins and reporting every 1 second. So that's like huge amount of data, but also the improvements are very beneficial. And here the trick was that all of those sensors and actuators coming from different vendors had different databases and ways of gathering data, multiple frameworks, and a really big setup and a lot of environments to sync. So that's also an interesting one. And the set of tools available here on the picture. So they wanted to have a hybrid solution because of the ability to, in some countries, they didn't have the proper data center hosting services like you have here. And they were then using the cloud, and in countries where they could find a good on-prem hosting, they were using that one. So next one is the smart agriculture. Here the cost was the key. It was a really simple process, just monitoring the meteorological information and chemicals in the soil. And again, here the whole MLOps process was focused on being as simple and as cheap as possible. So basically only open source components which are used on the local university. So the whole training and creating the models was done in R programming language. It was using things like Jump Kubernetes and Kubeflow in order to make it really cost efficient and easy to accommodate by the local farmers. And this was actually one of the biggest successes because the whole optimization of the potato growth gave them 23% growth in yield from the field. So even though you don't use super expensive tools, you can achieve amazing results. Next one is AGV control, automated ground vehicle. So that's a model that I was actually training myself as well. And this had high compute requirements and doing the coordination of a fleet of AGVs. And the trick here was that the model was deployed on a Jetson device, which is basically a small NVIDIA board, but it was trained in Kubernetes cluster. So a lot of image processing and also 3D image and a lot of synthetic data generation because we didn't have a possibility to record the videos in every possible light conditions, like very dark or very bright light and so on. So a lot of data were generated in a synthetic manner and the whole stuff was created on NVIDIA stack because of the Jetson deployment. So what we can conclude from these examples is that every MLOps setup is different and you need different tools to create it. It might be complicated if you are a data scientist and you don't want to put a lot of time into learning all of the ops stuff. And how you can save a lot of time with the tailored solution is model-driven operations. So as you know, we as data scientists a few years ago started automating our stuff. So we basically looked around and see that our colleagues in IT are using tools like Chef, Puppet, Ansible, Terraform, and so on for configuration management. And that's what we started using because why not? And then we saw that this is not good enough because we need to hard code many parameters, write many pieces of black bar scripts that are executed during the process. So we went over the evolution to a declarative deployment with Helm charts, YAML files. It was much easier to just define what we need and it happened. However, basically we ended up with thousands of lines of YAML configuration. So we improved even more, looking into Kubernetes and containers and the whole Kubernetes operators with imperative lifecycle management, which actually by containerizing different services made stuff much easier. And now I'm going to present you the even further evolution of that concept, which is called Juju, and this is about model-driven operations. So what Juju is doing is taking the application domain knowledge and distills it into code. The bonus is for us data scientists is that it's actually a Python code. So we are using mostly Python for all of our work, so we can have the operations coded in Python as well. So no huge amount, huge big YAMLs or XML files anymore. And how Juju is working, you get a model of your system, which is basically a graph of different connections between the pieces. And the applications are deployed by a thing called charm or charmed operator. How it works is basically with your command line or GUI, you have a Juju controller, which has an agent that can work with a charmed operator and your application. So in Kubernetes context, it means that it can create new namespaces, stateful sets, and so on, but everything is boiled down into really a simple commands like Juju deploy or Juju scale and the automation is happening. What's really important is that if you run the operators or Kubernetes, it's not touching your application at all. So the application container, the workload container is completely separate and you get a charmed container in the same Juju unit, which is doing all the actions. So you can very quickly and easily upgrade to different versions and do a lot of operations with your workload using that method. And if you want even more control of what's happening inside the workload, for example, if you are doing multi-instance GPU or GPU slicing for different workloads, giving them pieces of your physical GPU and so on, you can use a thing called Pebble, where you get a unique socket to inside the workload container to do some changes in real time, if that's what you need. Juju also comes with the concept of relations. And what a relation means is basically if you have Juju charms from open source download from the charm store, what you do, you can do Juju deploy Postgres, Juju deploy your application, and then relate them together. The whole thing that happens later is fully automated, so it knows that something can provide and something can require PostgreSQL. And if you juju relate your two applications together, everything that is needed will happen. So the network connectivity will be established, the databases are created, the passwords and usernames and everything that is necessary for these two applications to actually use one another. This happens in a fully automated manner on different environments. So the user experience is really simple. You have your Kubernetes deployed, like on ODP Kubernetes, for example, and then you talk to your Juju controller and you can deploy a different model. What a lot of our customers saw really beneficial is the fact that you actually can use it for a hybrid solution. So if you have a stuff deployed on the cloud here and you need something additional on-prem in your location or on any public cloud, you can do Juju deploy and just change the target, and Juju is aware and understands all the complexity behind it. So basically using that, you can choosing with different open source pieces, any MLOps infrastructure that you want to deploy and deploy it with a single command. The bonus is that it is fully open source, free to use. So you can just go to juju.is, download it and start using. And we are also supporting it if necessary in your enterprise use cases. We are happy to do that as well. So thank you very much for listening, and let's jump into the questions. If there are any questions, please put them on the chat or share with me.